Hey guys, it's DTakes23, and today GamerMD83 and I are joined by a very, very special guest, the voice of Sarah Ryder, Frieda Wolf. Unfortunately, Ability Drain was unable to meet up with us due to unforeseen circumstances with her internet connection, but she's with us in spirit. Thanks again for participating and sending in your questions. Let's get started.
We are live, you guys. Those of you in the chat, thank you so much for sticking around. We've got technical difficulties, my goodness.
Hey, welcome. Guys!
I am joined, I'm GamerMD83. We are here going to be chatting to, I'm joined by Denise Takes.
Hey guys.
Denise, did I say your last name right?
Yeah, you said it right.
Okay, good.
And the name of her people is Denise Takis.
People actually do say
we've
that.
We've got Takis. Translation, yeah. And the translator. And we're Ability Drain's having technical diff. She's actually being flooded at the moment. So hashtag pray for Ability
Drain. That makes
Drain.
It sound like a medical procedure.
Oh, she's being flooded.
She's being flooded right now.
Oh,
several
God, that sounds horrible.
Yeah, well, that's okay. She's not here. She's not here to tell us no.
Yeah, she's having issues with her internet. Hopefully she could join us in a little bit, but if not right now, it's us, and we are joined by the lovely Frieda Wolf.
Oh, hello.
she's a actress, voice actress, and the voice of Sarah Ryder in Mass Effect Andromeda, aside from many other roles. So welcome, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Oh, of course, people have been excited about this.
All and right. By the way, guys, I'm going to be giving away one standard edition of Mass Effect Andromeda for PS4 or Xbox One during the stream, so it's going to be happening later on, but I'll post a link in the chat just in case you haven't entered yet.
Yeah, it's going down. Thanks for doing that, Denise. That's awesome.
No problem.
So we will let the people come in. Ooh, lots of people are coming in. Nice. While we talk about our weekend. How was your weekend, ladies?
I think so. I have a brand new, as I've mentioned on Twitter, I have a brand new immigrant husband who adorably he came in on fiance visa, and the first suggestion in my mouth was like, what if I just fly in the day before Thanksgiving? I was like, no, you don't understand, because they don't do that over there. And I had to explain to him, the United States shuts down infrastructurally and cerebrally from the day before Thanksgiving onwards. No one wants to think or work or do anything. So that's how I'm doing. How's your senioritis?
Bless you.
I actually just moved to a new place, so my place is covered in boxes right now, and that's pretty much it.
Oh,
moving,
fun.
Packing. Yeah, lots of fun.
Congrats on the new place.
Thank you. Yeah, I love it.
I moved in February. I still live in boxes.
That's so many boxes.
Yep.
I am doing pretty much nothing. So yeah, that's my my weekend. It's been
excellent.
It's been pretty chill.
America succeeding at one thing.
Yeah, exactly. The Americans in the group. So just to make sure, everyone in the chat, can you hear the three of us? Everything sound good?
Me.
Now, there's a, Frieda, if you didn't know, there's a huge delay between us and Twitch. So when you ask any questions to the chat, you'll find yourself waiting for a while.
Okay.
But we've got to make sure that they could hear us. Yep. Okay. People saying, yeah. I wonder, am I on? The only one who's from Canada. Yes, you're good. Okay, perfect. So, Denise, thank you so much for organizing this, by the way.
No, of course.
So I
had to. As soon as I was like, I didn't think Frieda would actually respond. But
you guys
like,
have been really cool.
Yeah.
What? So, like, interview requests?
Yeah.
You ever talk to voice actors? Like, we would talk for free. We're just lucky that people are willing to throw us money.
No, you guys have been really cool with the community. It's been really cool.
Well, I mean, we're as excited as you two. It's goddamn Mass Effect.
I know, right?
freaking excited.
So we've got questions, some questions of our own, some fun questions. We are going to try to stay away from any particular or any specific Mass Effect Andromeda questions, so you don't, we don't see the little sniper dot on your forehead.
But, yeah, it's about that size. It comes in probably, you know, not that I imagine how I would get served papers, but I'd like to think it would be with a pizza delivery. Just to soften the blow of like, and you've been served, and I'm like, yes, I have. Yes, I have. Pepperoni, mushroom, olive.
That would be a good way to be served with your little pizza. It's like, you know what? I'm okay with this.
Yeah. No, Ea was pretty firm, and this is breaking NDA verbatim. What they said is, the only thing you can admit to is that you're a character in the game.
Oh.
So I'm a character in the game, and that's the end of the interview.
Ta-da! Spoilers! Oh no. But we also have some questions that we've put together from the fans. Fans asked some questions, so this should be pretty fun. And we'll be taking some questions every now and then from the chat. So if you guys want to ask some stuff, feel free to post in the chat, and we'll go through them every now and then. So yeah, let's get started.
Yeah. So I guess
love goats. Someone asked if anyone else loves goats, and like, who doesn't love goats?
That's a good question.
Satan actually doesn't love goats. That's the only one. That's the only one. Everyone loves goats.
So I guess we should start off with Mass Effect Trilogy. Everyone wants to know if you've played the Mass Effect Trilogy.
No, I'm the worst, and I've enjoyed... Okay, so I made a Google alert for myself a long time ago, and now I get Google alert emails for when people talk about me in forums, which... yeah, which is super fun when you're already like, don't read the comments. Oh, what's God, this link? Yeah. God damn it!
And there have been a lot of alerts.
Not that many. I mean, it's not every forum ever. Like, I get... It's like a stupid pat on the back. I get an alert every time I update my own website. Oh. Which is really masturbatory and dumb. but I've been made to look at some comments where people are like, she said she doesn't play the game, so I really don't have confidence in her as an actor, but Tom's great. Yeah, well, yeah. You guys, like, hit the jackpot with Tom. Tom is a BioWare RPG Mass Effect nerd. Like, he loves to talk about how he's sat and watched and listened to every codex and whatever. And me, I mean, I come from game development, historically in my employment background, and I'm a gamer since teenage years. I'm the kind of person where my parents didn't want me playing games, so they wouldn't buy me a console, so I had every PC game ever in high school in like the mid-90s. But I'm more of like a hack and slash murder file. So too much dialogue. There's so much talking. Please stop talking so I can murder you and loot you and level up and go to the next person that I murder and loot and level up, please. The answer is no. So I played 20 minutes of Mass Effect 1 when it was new, and I couldn't find the first trigger to get the next part after the crash site, and I was like, okay, well, F this game. And then after getting this gig, I tried again on my PC, and Steam says I have 79 minutes played. Because I started doing combat and the auto crouch thing. Auto crouch, no good. So I wonder if I could turn that off. So I've made a public vow that I'm gonna try to plow through Mass Effect 2 over the break, because I mean it's pretty good timing. You know, the next 2 weeks are dead. I'm not gonna be doing any family stuff or traveling. So it's a perfectly good, no excuse time to actually chew into one, but I think Mass Effect 2 is the one I'm going to do. Would you guys agree that that's a good
one? That's my favorite one, yeah.
That's my favorite one, too, yeah.
I've chosen wisely, then.
You have.
Yeah, so that's my answer to that. Like, I I'm not alone, because Josh Dean, who y'all have seen me go back and forth with on Twitter, like one of the first sessions, he's like, so how do you feel about RPG games? I'm like, they're talking. She's like, me too. There's nothing more important than unskippable cutscenes or unskippable dialogue.
Oh man, that's interesting. So then, since you like hack and slash types of games, what's your favorite game?
Well, I think a lot of things derive from Diablo 1 and 2. It's just like a lot of a lot of really good stuff spiraled out from there. And even, you know, those games were not original or unique in their gameplay or anything, but like Blizzard does a really good job of taking bits and pieces, Magpie and other people's ideas and other people, I mean, it's not controversial, whatever, Warhammer came first, but they do a really good job of making other people's ideas more digestible, more accessible, whether it's via the HUD, the UI, the gameplay itself. So they just like make endless money. So that was just like definitely the point of origin for me. And then from there I became like a Left 4 Dead, Battlefield, TF2 junkie, all that kind of stuff where you can, when you can get in it, again, violating all the rules of an RPG, games where you can get in and out and feel like you've accomplished something within half an hour are really good. That's a really good amount of serotonin, adrenaline hit for me of like, okay, I've done something and now I can go back to work or whatever.
Yeah.
The ones that require, you know, borderline part-time job, time commitment. Right? I mean, like, look, so I, when I came up playing games for my teen years and my 20s, at the same time, I was like really indulging the Blizzard stuff. So Warcraft 2 and Diablo 1 and then 2. That's when EverQuest really hit it for World of Warcraft. And the average MMO player was playing at least 20 to 25 hours a week. Literally a part-time job.
Oh, man.
So I was able to justify. That's another thing, too. Because MMOs are forced multiplayer, not necessarily, like, sure, plenty of people sold it up through multiplayer, but because multiplayer was usually designed where you would not do well if you didn't party up, and I really got off on community building and hanging out with a guild and hanging with my real-life friends because I was a teenager and I couldn't drive and all that stuff. That I could justify because I was hanging out with friends, but playing alone and really escaping into a world by yourself like an RPG, I think that was just too lonely for me personally. That yeah. probably speaks more to my personality and what I was, you know, what I was going through as a kid versus the quality of the game. Because especially now that I have lived a Mass Effect game through performing it, it kind of just dawned on me, if you're playing especially like a BioWare game, you are living your little fantasy sci-fi novel out to your heart. I mean, you're choosing your own adventure to your heart's content. You're doing the thing that movie adaptations attempt to do,
yeah,
but don't always accomplish, because like when you read a book, you in your head are making the movie adaptation, right? Like you're doing the casting, yeah, you're there, totally. Just deciding what the set looks like, blah blah blah, and then you see the movie and you're like, fuck, what's better? Well, like a game, you're given your set of cast of characters, your props, your environments and stuff, so you accept it. You have nothing else to, you know, base it on, compare it to, so you're like, oh, this is better, this is worse, and you're immediately there having that experience with those people, which is why, like I've said in another Mass Effect interview so far, where people are like, what's it like doing, having so much responsibility at the head of multi-million-dollar blah 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 blah. Down to the thing that I've seen people most repeat, and I absolutely agree with, they're like, I can't wait to spend hundreds of hours with you. Which out of context is so creepy, but like, I get it. You're gonna be wearing my, you know, my 3D model skin suit and using my mouth sounds or Tom's mouth sound to live your little experience as you would in a book. So to wrap up that whole rant, like it always comes back to me when was it Roger Ebert who said video games aren't art?
Oh hell.
Oh. Okay, as a commercial artist, which, so fine artist makes their own creative content, a commercial artist helps other people bring their visions to fruition. Mm-hmm. The whole reason we pay for art or attend art is because we're desperate to feel something, anything, yeah. Right? Like, yeah, make absolutely. You feel something when you go to a movie, read a book, or whatever. Mm-hmm. So if you feel something while playing a video game, then we did our jobs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
totally yeah. agree.
And those are the games I play. Anyway.
People are agreeing with you, and they're saying they're saying Blizzard is bae, so they're excited that you like Blizzard.
They're saying yeah, of course. You're bae.
Yeah, that too.
Oh, you! What languages will they come up with next?
I know, right?
Okay, we have another question. It's Mass Effect. You haven't played the trilogy, but There's one question that says, Angry Wolves asks, do you or have you ever met Mark Meer or Jennifer Hale?
Mark Meer, no, because he's out in Canada. But he's, I mean, I've seen the pictures. That guy. Did you guys know he actually like LARPs? He LARPs.
He does. Oh, really? Yeah, he totally does. He's a huge nerd and it's awesome.
Before Mass Effect, LARPed since Mass Effect, and like he does all the insane, I mean, I'm a huge fan of cosplayers because they do so much work that I'm not willing to do. Also not artistically capable of, but like the amount of material, assembly and construction. No. And he actually does it. So he seems awesome. I haven't met him. I've met Jennifer Hale like 5 or 6 times.
Oh, nice.
Which means is like, I'm not a major player in this community. So I don't think I'm very memorable. So I've met her for the first time, like 5 or 6 times. It's fine.
Oh,
never. She gets like, this poor woman gets harassed in Twitter all the time where I mean, fans don't mean to do it, they just don't know that it's like the 9th or 10th time today that someone has what they think is a very original tweet where they're like, I really enjoyed Jennifer Hale's performance, but I'm really looking forward to at Frida's performance. I'm like, this poor woman is getting harassed over something that she's not in. Oh, Jesus Christ. So that's fine. One day it'll happen to me. One day it'll happen to me.
Yeah, it will. It will.
Just yeah. Wait. Yeah.
I think what a lot of people wanted to know was, how did you get started in voice acting?
It was a lateral move for me. I was in game development for 12 years, most of which was as a sound designer. And when you work in audio, anybody who works in audio can attest, you get very comfortable being in a recording studio. If you're a sound designer, you're doing stuff like recording Foley all the time. So Foley is when you see the most kitschy basic thing. If you see someone banging coconuts to a horse on a screen, that's Foley, basically doing live sound design to match to picture. And also in game, you get thrown in the booth all the time to do temp stuff or creature VO or whatever you want to do. So I was doing that on a regular basis, and I didn't connect that it was training, because you don't think of it as training. And then someone paid me for VO once. Long story short, when you're in audio, you are sometimes made to wear a lot of hats. The smaller the studio you work at, the more responsibility you carry. So you might be like the audio director, which means you are the VO producer who's doing scheduling and budgeting and co-directing, and you are the sound designer, and you are the implementer who's implementing all the sounds, and you are either also the composer or your contracting composers. Wow. Or if you work at a bigger place where you can have, you know, multiple headcount for that department, those jobs are spread out. Very often, if someone, like a client, some kind of client knows you work in audio, they just assume you can do all the other stuff or that you've done all the other stuff. And we're just like, we're lying. You know, I was in game audio. I was like, so you've done voiceovers, right? And I was like, huh? Oh, this is for a job. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yup. He had me do, it's the what's called IVR, which I don't know what it stands for off the top of my head, but IVR is phone system stuff. So every time you call a company and they have their automated, hi, welcome, you've called da-da-da, and for her it's, you've called the Costco auto program. I've been doing that VO since 2009?
Oh, man.
10 or something? That was the first time I got paid for VO, and every creative person, the first time you get money for the thing that you would do for free, that's like the needle going and you're like, oh, I could do this again. I could do this more. Yeah. I continued on with working full-time in games, but because I lived in Orange County at the time, I just started going up to LA, so that's like a 2 to 3 hour commute. But I was going on nights and weekends for fun, doing for fun VO classes and improv. And I've said I think that contributed a lot, because I did that for 4 years in a row. So that was like essentially my college education later in life. And then at 30, I switched over from being a sound designer in games to doing VO full time, and I started working immediately. And I really do think that is because I did all the acting education, I did improv and all that stuff without the pressure of it needing to make me money. It didn't have to pay me rent. It was for fun. Right. So my brain and my nerves were relaxed about it. There wasn't pressure. Like when you, so you know how like nobody is themselves at a job interview because they really, if you want the job, and you're like, you have cold sweats, and you're just like so nervous, and you're just like, ah!
And you wearing walk out, clothes like, that you don't ever wear,
and you have a total out of body experience.
Yeah.
If you're that, if there's that much riding on like every audition you do, for example, you won't book anything because you're petrified. So I think because I got to play around for so long without needing to make me money, I just sort of relaxed into it, and I was like, oh. And I've noted, I mean, I make this analogy a lot, but it just really holds up. You have to treat it like dating. If you go on a bunch of dates and you're just so desperate for love because your eggs are drying up and no one's ever going to make you a mother, and you're just, you know, you have waking nightmares that they're going to find your body half eaten by your cats. So much is riding on every date that you're like, please. Then nobody calls you back. Whereas you walk into a room or into a date and you're like, hi, nice to meet you. Okay. Yeah, no, I can give you 10 minutes of my time. Bye. They call you back. The less I want to work, the more I book.
Oh, interesting.
So, the more I'm like, I just want to do my laundry. And then that's just in a row or something absurd. Because that's just how it works. I think any freelancer would tell you the same thing. Being an actor, being a voice actor is much more like being a regular contractor freelancer, because on-camera actors who do television or film, those contracts, unless you're doing like a commercial, those aren't day jobs, right? Like you're on a film set for 2 weeks, 2 months, 2 years. Mm-hmm. Or if you're doing a television show, you have this regular production schedule, like every day, Monday through Friday, sometimes Saturday, and night shoots, you're da-da-da-da-da. For voice actors, our turnaround time on jobs is like maybe a one-hour session or a two-hour session or up to a four-hour session. So we get fired every day. You do. We get fired every day. I get fired multiple times a day. I have a book. I'm your best friend. Yeah. And then it's like, thanks very much. Bye. And now I don't have a job again. And that's every day. So again, that's why you can't have the pressure of like, I need to pay rent. I need to make money. because that just, it seeps into your audition, seeps into every job you do. It seeps into your attitude. And it's so repugnant to humans. So yeah, but like the confidence isn't fake. The confidence is just like, I'll be fine. I don't care. I just want to buy groceries. I can confirm. I order food in way too much because I'm just too tired. And I'm like, I don't have time.
I just want to eat.
I just want to buy apples. Anyway, that's what that's like.
What was the transition like from sound design to voiceover?
Pretty lateral. So what happens, like when I was coming up and doing classes, one of the persons I did classes with was Richard Horvitz. He's the voice of Invader Zim, and I never remember his name in Psychonauts, and he's the main bad dude in Skylanders, blah, blah, blah. Horvitz is a long time game and animation person, and like a good fan. Like every time I get also the question of like, how do you become a voice actor? I have a tab on my website where
I'll just go to the tab.
But every single, like, I didn't just email people with, like, how did I become a voice actor? I Googled my ass off. Yeah. So with, like, Richard Horvitz, I just plugged in his name, went to his website. What do you know? He teaches classes. Okay. And he also produces demos. So when I was like, oh, okay, let's make some demos, I just called him up. And I was very ready after, you know, 4 years of, like, casually doing VO on my own time. Mm-hmm. So we did, you traditionally do what's called an animation demo, which is, this is very out of date. The acting industry, the actor factory is always chasing after what the creatives are trying to do and trying to catch up. And not everyone is an early adopter. So what I mean by that is like people who are not participating in the medium don't necessarily have an understanding of what the hell they're auditioning for. And then they do this thing where like, I don't know, I'm booking. I want to get into video games. Do you play? Do you watch? Do you Twitch? No? Okay, well, that's your answer. So they used to break it up where that you were required a commercial demo, an animation demo, and a video game demo, which is nonsense. Because really, what's the difference between animation and video game VO?
Nothing. Nothing. You're just playing fantastical characters.
So now you're just required a commercial demo, which is exactly what it sounds like, and an animation demo. So I made those with Richard, and what I did is, again, on my own, because I Googled my butt off, there's a website called Voice Bank, and you can look up every demo of everyone who's working through an agent in the world, and you can look up every agency. I cold called, copy pasted with my dumb little Gmail account about 120 agencies. Most of them in LA, some like in other places, because I was told to get as many agents as possible, which, by the way, you don't, because if you're working for a great agency, they will keep you very busy with, like, you will suffer trying to keep up with auditions anyway.
Yeah.
Because there's work to go around. I don't get every audition done because sometimes I'm working or I'm sick or I'm traveling or I just cannot keep up. Uh-huh. And then there are days you get no auditions. So anyway, I sent out my demos, copy paste, email, 120-ish emails. I got 10 responses back, which, is, by the way, is phenomenal that 10 emails came back to someone who no one's ever heard of, hasn't done any work through an agency before, isn't coming from another agency. I didn't name drop in my email. I was very plain about my name is Frida Wolf. I speak fluent Mexican Spanish. I'm FICOR, which means I can do union, non-union. Here are my demos. Here's a link to my website. Have a nice day. I didn't say, I come from video games, blah, 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 blah. No. Also, I thought it would just be better for me if I didn't. Like, nobody likes someone who's greasy anyway. I'm sure other people would argue with me of, like, you should be aggressive and name drop and, like, really brag about where you come from. But, again, I find that repugnant. Uh-huh. So I expect other people to find it repugnant. So I called Richard. I emailed Richard, saying, Richard Horvitz, again, who did the demos. I was like, I got 10 responses back. I don't know any of these agencies. Can you vet or discourage some of those? I don't know. And he left me this voicemail, which I wish I'd saved, because it starts off with, like, wow, well, congratulations to you, but mostly to me, because, I mean, obviously my demos are amazing. He and I are at the same agency, and we just had our holiday party, and I went up to him, and he's like, thanks to me. I know Richard. I have different demos now, but yes, I know Richard. So bizarrely, of the 10 agencies that got back to me, one of them was the agency that Richard was about to leave, and the other was the agency he was going to, and nobody knew yet. And he was like, I mean, just so you know. So I was like, well, I want to go with Daddy. And the agency that he was going to, which is where I'm at now, they were the only ones who weren't offering me a contract outright. They were like, we'll do what's called a hip pocketing in LA. When you hip pocket someone, you basically treat them as a freelancer. They're not signed to the agency, and the agency can drop you on any auditions that they send you. They still take their 10%. So you're basically working as a contractor rather than like a member of the family. Like it's the mafia or something. So I did that for them for 8 months, and then they signed. And for a couple of years, like at holiday parties, they were like drunkenly apologizing and laughing, because the only reason that agency gave me a shot was because I speak fluent Spanish and I don't have an accent in either language. They didn't think my reads were very good. They didn't think the auditions I was submitting was very good. They really didn't think anything about me. The only angle I had, and like a junior assistant who wasn't even a full agent at the time, was like, we should really give her a shot. I mean, it's really rare to be bilingual, not have an accent in either language. Like, we should really, they're like, ugh, whatever. And they still bring it up like a joke on them, that's the only reason that they took an interest, because I've obviously done very well for them. I make them money. And Tom Taylorson, he was a teacher for, I always forget. He was teaching in Chicago. That's how we have our Octodad connection. Mm-hmm. And he was telling the students, like, he would use that story of how I got with my current agency, of like, you have to have just that something else that only you bring to even just get an audience with agents, because agents do get demos every day. Mm-hmm. And if they think that they already have what you offer in their stable, they're going to be like, pass. We don't want you competing with who we already have, for example. So, LA's tricky. That's also when people are like, how do you become a voice actor? It's in the same way of like, how do you become a freelance artist? One creative's path is not going to in any way mirror image someone else's path. Everybody gets there somewhere, some other way.
Some of
the basics be the same, but it's not like becoming a doctor. You have to go to college, and then you have to do pre-med, and then you have to pass all these board exams. Like, we don't have that. We just get here how we get here.
Yeah.
My mic's not very good. What's wrong with my mic?
I saw that. I hear you fine. Are you guys, is she like cutting in and out? Maybe it's your internet? Because we hear her fine. Do you want to I only saw one person saying that.
Okay.
I don't know if maybe they were having some issues.
If anyone else says my...
Yeah. Could you guys hear Frida okay?
Is my mic okay? Do I sound like a person?
I can hear her fine, says...
Yeah.
Maybe there was a Skype blip or something.
Yeah, I think so. I hear her fine, too. Yeah, okay. Cool.
Thank you for confirm.
Yeah, if you're having issues, refresh your page. Sometimes it could be the internet. So awesome. A lot of people want to know how the did you put a little bit of yourself when voicing Sarah Ryder, says Adrian Anderson, like a bit of your personality?
Yeah, of course. I this also just goes hand in hand with when people are like, what is the advice you give to voice act? So a lot of the stuff that you are told, or at least I was very like, this is horseshit. And then it's all true. Everything everyone tells you is 120% true. And one of the things you hear when you ask people is you will book most of the time for who you are and how you sound, point blank, whatever your natural personality is, whatever the natural quality is of your voice, more than any other goofy SpongeBob-y character you have in you. Those will book too. Mm-hmm. But who you are is what resonates, obviously, the most, as most real, most authentic to people, because it's who you are. It's not rocket science. But it is unbelievable, because so many people think that voice acting is about, quote, doing voices.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it's about acting. So
okay, that's so it's I think I've actually heard that before, where it's like, if you're gonna do an audition, just go in there with your pretty much normal voice, and then if you do get the job, then you could play with it later.
Well, this is what I so like. I add and subtract my personality, and I'm sure other people do it the same way. They just maybe articulate it differently. So like, if I get in very vague terms with Ryder, it's easy. Okay, it's like, so start with baseline me. How would I sound, and what would I feel like if Alec Ryder is my father? If these things have happened to me, this is my background. This is how I feel about XYZ. This is my education. You know what I mean? Like all those things. Mm-hmm. Versus how would I be if I was raised in a trailer park and my mother died when I was 3? And you know what I mean? So like, you add and subtract all those things in your brain of how you would process those experiences, and out comes out some part of yourself that as a result does sound different from who you are. It's still you. Even when you're doing so, like, pitch is not gender or age. The best case for that is Bob's Burgers.
Oh my god, yeah.
Right? Yeah. But it works perfectly well. Like, that's exceptional, great casting, great voice acting, because everybody, like, even Dan Mintz, who, by the way, that's just Dan Mintz's voice, who does Tina, that's how he is day to day. That's him getting groceries and ordering a pizza. I must really be into pizza right now. But yeah, that's just Dan. And all Dan does is go in there and he's like, how would I feel if I'm a 12-year-old girl and I really like butts? And just go from there. But that's the truth. He wasn't like, let me do a voice for y'all. That's just him adding and subtracting who he is in that situation. So it's the same thing for Ryder, and it's the same thing for everything I do. So in the same way where you can, like, if you listen really hard and you recognize people in, like, different cartoons and in different games, mm-hmm. and stuff, but they're still playing different characters, even if you held those up back-to-back, they're probably not exactly the same performance.
Yeah, totally.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, I have a question from Monster Tess. She asks, do you feel a lot of pressure on the role as Sarah Ryder, since Mass Effect is a really loved franchise?
Obviously. I apologize in advance. I'm like, I hope I didn't screw up your experience. Oh, God. Look, so for my part, all I could do was just go in every day, bust ass, and be like, so long as I can walk out of here and be convinced that I did the best I could do today, that has to be good enough for me. That's all I can do. So I just... same for Tom. You just go in there and we just, like, walk out loopy, emotional messes, because the gear shifting is really hard. Because in a session, it's not like, it's not like in one session we're like, today we're going to do all the grieving scenes, tomorrow we're going to do all the sex scenes, and then the next day we're going to do all the happy scenes. And it's not like that. Like, we do stuff as it gets done and ready to record. So it would just be like, within 5 minutes, be like, okay, you know, sex scene, diplomatic scene, expository question, talk to dad, get on a spaceship. And then just have to be emotionally present for all of that in equal measure. That's really, really hard work. And by the end of it, it really does something to your brain.
Oh, man, I can imagine.
Kind of melty. Like, the last 5 minutes, I usually would be just like a giggling puddle. With also, also when I'm not paid attention, I just start like pulling up the back of my hair. So by the end of every session, I just look like the Statue of Liberty. I put a video on my YouTube that actually, like, they didn't tell me they were recording, where I was losing it, and Josh, the director, is talking me down. He's like, you can do this, you have five. So I was like, yeah, I didn't miss it,
and your hair is all like sticking up. They're like, oh, she's yeah. Done.
Yeah, so no, all I could do is do my best every day. And I know, like, Tom and everybody else, I mean, even now, like, I have survivor's guilt because I'm ex-dev, and I crunch in that, you know, having a lot of sessions back to back for a game, or if I'm in something that has a trade show coming up, like a PAX or an E3, we get those jammed in. So I used to brag about, like, oh, I never have to crunch again. That's a total lie. I crunch with teams, but, you know, we're done at six, and also voice is a finite resource. So if you run someone over 4 hours, you're already getting diminishing returns. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, you know, on Twitter, y'all can see the Mass Effect Andromeda team is still working, and they're crunching their butts off all the way up until the holidays and potentially through. Absolutely. So, I mean, I feel a lot less pressure on me and a lot more pressure on them, because they're giving up, you know, hours of their lives they're not going to give back.
I know.
Make this game good. Yeah. So, I'm sure everyone is just doing the best they can do.
Yeah.
Yeah. When you go, since you're voicing a character that is also being voiced pretty much exactly the same character, just the male and the female, with Tom Taylorson, how do you guys, do they get you both in the same room and talk to you, okay, this is how you're going to approach this scene, or is it, do they give you freedom pretty much to voice it however you want, or do they want you to stick to kind of like the same for male and female writer?
We've never recorded at the same time in the same room. The whole game has been done in solitary confinement, which is normal for voice acting ensemble. Is super, super rare in games. Mm-hmm. The only time we've had to match each other is when something is already cut for time. Mm-hmm. And, like, I talk a lot faster than Tom. And if Tom laid it down first and they've locked in for timing, I have to take the dramatic pauses with Tom. Oh. Sorry about that.
Oh.
And vice versa. Just because we're not, this is not, so in animation, you're invited to take a lot of liberties, sometimes ad lib, and just go for broke, because you're a co-conspirator with the writers. You're expected to bring in your ideas and your impetus about the character, and then they go home and animate around you. Games are not like that, because it's so much more technically rigid. First of all, by the time we get scripts, they've already been hand-typed, plugged into a game, and then exported from the game. They're also locked down for localization to be translated into other languages. So it's not our job to make the script better or to add our ideas. Just read the words that are on the page, which can be tough for actors if you're like caught in a moment. Like, I have brain autocorrect problems. My brain will just like autocorrect, make a suggestion, and be like, well, that's not the word. And I'm like, well, my brain thought it was better. And I'm really not... doing it, which is problematic, because, you know, that eats up time and we have to go back. Otherwise, Tom and I had the freedom to when scenes that we, you know, that were flipped, where someone's hero and the other one's the sibling that's hanging out, mm-hmm. we had the freedom to be whatever interpretation or emotion or dynamic that we wanted to be within reason. We just had to account. It's just so much more technical. Like, this is not like, say, oh, here's a perfect example. So a few years ago, Benedict Cumberbatch and Johnny Lee Miller were both in Frankenstein in the National Theatre in London. And I got to, like, watch it in a movie theater. So I got to watch, like, this really gorgeously taped version of it, mm-hmm. of them doing the play live. And every night they switched where one night somebody would be the Dr. Frankenstein and the other night somebody would be the monster.
Oh, wow.
It was great. So I happened to catch it when Benedict Cumberbatch was Dr. Frankenstein and Johnny Lee Miller was the monster. Mm-hmm. This is not like that, where every night you're getting a slightly different show and they can just like play to how they want it. Mm-hmm. We could be as emotional as we wanted, but like certain technical limitations can't change, like timing for cutscenes, like mm-hmm. if we're video game VO is really, 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 really friggin' technical. Because like, for example, I have to do VO that's neutral, say, regardless of whether the character I'm talking to is in front of me, 6 feet away, or across a ravine.
Oh,
wow. Or maybe the scene is happening over combat, so I have to be louder. Right. I can't be quiet and intimate. No one, like, that's not realistic. It wouldn't be heard.
Yeah.
Stuff like that. So like, we're married to that. So just because if this is a scene where I'm angry and I feel like getting louder, but the character's in my face, that's no longer an option that I have. Does it make sense?
Yeah, yeah.
Whereas if you're performing a play live, there's a lot of room for you to play around.
Right.
And do, like, a lot of theater, musical theater people will talk about how one of their favorite things of doing live theater is that every night is an opportunity to do something different or do something better or kind of, like, get revenge for something that didn't go the way you wanted the night before. We don't get to do that. It's like a one and done.
Oh, man. That's got to be tough. I mean, there's fun and like the challenge must be really, you know, a challenge that is I don't know, like thrilling or whatever, but it's got to be tough, especially with the different types of personalities that you have to voice for. You know, there's usually like the diplomatic protagonist, or there's the funny protagonist, or there's the mean protagonist, and it's you have to voice it, but you still have to keep like this neutral ground there for the person, for the player to add their own.
Yeah, one of the hardest things for doing, I mean, I've said this again in other interviews, like I have like combat veteran solidarity. Veterans of war who meet other veterans of war already love them like brothers, right? And have like additional love and respect. That's how I feel about anybody who's worked in a BioWare game.
Oh.
It is the toughest thing. It describing it as boot camp is not, that's not enough.
Wow.
it's a hard freaking work.
I would love to see the protagonists of BioWare games just come together.
the hardest bit of that kind of work for me is, so BioWare games do have extensive amounts of expository and exploration for you. Like, if you want to talk to every single NPC in a whatever, in a market, in a place of worship, in an outpost, whatever, they set it up. So there's dialogue with, you know, every NPC, especially if it's going to give you like a side quest or something.
Right.
And we would do hours where we had to start, every line is like, so tell me more about this. And what's your business here? And that sounds pretty da-da-da. I mean, you're familiar with this, right? That is the hardest shit in the world. And I'll tell you what. So, like, what I had to do, what worked for me is I had to start every single, in my head, like, not saying it so it wouldn't be recorded, but I had to do this pre-life of, so, and then I'd start the line, tell me more about how you got here. Because what happens is, if you get exhausted and bored as the actor, it comes out your mouth. Mm-hmm. And yeah. I can't do that for you guys, because you're like, man, Sarah sounds really over it. What? Maybe I shouldn't. It
just stop happening. She's so done.
She needs a nap. So I keep up. It really sounds inane, but that is the hardest stuff, of just like keeping up your sincere energy and interest level of like, I mean, I'm staring at my printer. So, how long have you had this printer? Well, I mean, what does it do for you? Can you tell me more about the significance of this printer for your people?
For your people.
Right? Hours of that. That is hard, because I'm not having, especially when you're just like talking about stuff to a person and you don't have that actual, I mean, this isn't like, I'm playing Barbara Walters, but at least Barbara Walters or Oprah or whoever like has another human in front of them.
Yeah.
So they can stay engaged and interested. I have to pretend real hard. That's definitely like the hardest book of the work. And there's so much of it. Mm-hmm. Like, not a spoiler. You can talk to everyone in Mass Effect. Everyone.
About everything.
About everything that, like, I would kind of, like, lose it a bit, and I'd just be like, just hold up. Ryder is so rude. It is none of your business. It is none of your business how long this vendor has been here doing this, or how they feed their, how dare you? You have no manners. Or just, like, busting, right? Or just, like, busting in somebody's diplomatic meeting and being like, what's up? What's up? What's up? Who invited you? You are not on the Gmail invite. Leave. Anyway. But that's for you guys, so you can do that to your heart's content.
Awesome.
So during the interview we had with Tom Taylorson, he told us an amazing story about how you guys found out you were working together. Can you tell us what happened in your own words?
He just loves telling people that I broke NDA. friend DA, as we call it. So basically, Tom moved from Chicago a year and a half ago in, like, spring, summer of, and he doesn't live quite around me, so he was like, well, this day I have a session at this studio in Burbank, are you going to be nearby? I mean, the majority, if you want to become a voice actor, you're going to end up having to move to LA, and you can do VO anywhere in the world, but anywhere else in the world it will be like a part-time job or hobby for you. It can only be a full-time living in LA, and that's just because so many of the contracts that actually pay out enough money for you to make a living on it require studio time here. The clients are here. It's like a self-perpetuating thing. So you'll end up coming to LA if you want to do VO full-time. So he moved here. He's like, I'm going to be... Oh, and my point of that, too, is like the majority of small studios that do animation and games are in Burbank, too. So he's like, I'm going to be in Burbank that day. Do you want to try having lunch that day? And I was like, I'm going to be in Burbank at that studio the next day. Let's play a game. And the game is called, Are We on the Same Game? And he's like, I don't know. And I was like, okay, is this game in space? He's like, maybe. I'm like, okay, is this game from Canada? Like, maybe. And I was like, well, I'm real sorry to tell you, Tom, but I'm the lead player character for Mass Effect. And he's like, no, Frida, I'm the player character for Mass Effect.
Yeah. That's so cool.
What? I just, like, sat in the car just like... so that was cool. So we were like, okay, we can't tell anyone that we told each other. They weren't organized about it either, because we, like a month or two go by, and I'm in a session with Caroline Livingstone, who you all know is the main VO producer. She was Skyping in Edmonton, and she just casually said something about, like, yeah, we had Tom Taylorson on the other day. I'm like, okay, I'm not going to act like I don't know now, because she said the name, so she's made it okay. Even though they never told, right, by the way, your counterpart is, do you know him? Have you heard of him? She never, like, nobody ever did any formal introduction. Rightfully so. Like, you have to remember, these people... especially, like, Caroline is the head of that department. They're responsible for so many actors, so much scheduled time, so many different studios. Each actor has an individual contract per session that has to be followed up on and signed for and paid for. And on top of that, you know, keep her shit straight with the scripts. Like, it's an incredibly back-breaking job. So, of course, like, they wouldn't, like, by the way, we have to make sure that the actors know who the other actors are, and just, like, let's take the time to walk them through it. They don't have time for that.
Frida, but this is Tom.
Casually, Frida. In a session, so I was like, okay, well, she said it, and she, like, mentioned it casually around Tom, so, like, one day, months in, I was like, by the way, I don't know if you know, but Tom was Octodad. I'm in Octodad, and they're like, what's Octodad? They didn't know. They'd never heard the game. It was, like, a blip.
So, it was just complete coincidence that you two were... That's so cool. It's meant to be.
Yeah. Really, really cool. Also, like, just funny for Tom, because he's from Chicago. I believe his wife's from Chicago. They have two kids and two dogs. Like, he had the total suburban lifestyle down and accomplished. He was, my understanding of Tom is he's never not been an actor. So he was doing theater, and he was teaching game design students. He got involved with Octodad because DePaul University, where the Octodad team is from, they have a program where you can work with union actors at a cut rate so that students get the opportunity to work with real actors and direct them and, you know, be part of that process. And the actors get a cheapy little day and get to play with kids. And so that's how Tom met young horses before they like Octodad was there. In case people don't know, Octodad was the final exam for their game design degree. And they had such success with it that 9 of the 12 original kids incorporated. And the Octodad that we all know is their do-over that shipped. Oh. That was based on a class project to get their degree.
Wow.
And they hired Tom, you know, as a student teacher situation. So Mass Effect is the first game that Tom booked since moving to LA. He's fine.
He's fine. Don't worry about him.
Now, because, you know, he had his whole life set up and going well in Chicago. But, if you want to do VO full time, you have to be in LA. There's just no way around it. And thankfully, like, his wife is very supportive. She has a job where she could also transfer here easily. His kids have transferred. So he's doing really well. So, yeah, it's obviously really nice and kooky and funny that Octodad people get to, like, share this experience. And we couldn't wait for N7 announcements because we were just dying to tell the Young Horses guys. Because we just wanted to be proud.
Yeah, yeah. That you two are, yeah, no, that's cool. I love that story. A lot of people have their mind blown right now. They're mind blown right now.
Octodad. And if we're being honest, we still don't know.
It's a mystery.
It's an experience.
I say we go to the chat for a little bit. We've been ignoring these poor people. A lot of them are saying, let's see what they're saying. What sort of advice? Okay, no, you've answered more. Are there people?
I saw one that was posted frequently, so we better answer that question.
Yeah, go ahead.
There's a Frida. Have you played Dragon Age Origins, Dragon Age 2, and/or Dragon Age Inquisition? Do you have a favorite character in Dragon Age?
No.
That was a quick answer.
In a BioWare game beyond the 20 and then 79 minutes of Mass Effect 1. I'm a quitter. I'm a very good quitter. I'm the best quitter you've ever met. They talk to... No, it's just... Yeah. I just want to murder and stuff. Sorry. I'm not... But, like, I've said this before, and I do think it's true. So, just, like, a rule of thumb, again, with, like, auditions and stuff, in the same way where you can't be needy and desperate. Mm-hmm. I actually don't mind it when I don't know exactly what I'm auditioning for, because then I can't get nervous or precious about it. A lot of people will say, you can't want it, because if you want it, you won't book it.
Oh,
because you're not doing your job anymore. So just like, so y'all imagine that you're like, whoever your biggest childhood hero, or just someone who just like the thought of just like makes your heart explode out of your chest.
Uh-huh.
And like a second later, boom, we put them in front of your face and you have your opportunity. What are you going to do? Nothing. You're going to say nothing. You're going to do nothing.
Everything that you've ever trained in.
Language that you speak, and they're going to walk in here and be like, what the hell was that?
Yeah. And you're going to be so bad.
That's what happens when you're doing auditions, and if you're like really consumed with excitement and obsession and pressure, da 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 da, you're like, I really want this. You're not going to get it because your brain is no longer able to compartmentalize and do the job and be present as that character. Like we're in an age of a lot of like animated reboots, for example, like Voltron through DreamWorks Netflix and all that stuff. And when I see reboot stuff come through that I'm excited about, I'm like, oh no, because like it's too precious, and then two, I'm so married to what was done,
right,
that sometimes I can't even think of something new to do because I'm just like way too clingy, and it's like, okay, well, I'm not gonna get this. I have to let it go. If I can't separate my feelings, it's not gonna work. So the script I got for Andromeda was just like, it was a dummy script. EA has a set of dummy scripts that they send out on a regular basis that multiple years in a row, it's the same script, and they're just sent out very obviously as like, can you be a human? Can you be a person talking to other people? Here's our generic test. And that's what I booked off. Yeah. If I'd gotten an audition that said, for the lead of the next Mass Effect. Exactly. Even not as a BioWare fangirl, I still would have been like, oh no, that's too big. That's too big.
Yeah.
Oh no. Oh no. Oh. So I think it's actually really beneficial. I mean, this is part of the strike conversation now. Like, one of the tenants is wanting total transparency on game auditions. There have been instances, it hasn't happened to me, but like, for example, I was listening to somebody's podcast with some some interview, mm-hmm. and an actress shows up to the job, and it turns out it was God of War, and she was there to do a sex scene, which she was incredibly uncomfortable with. And she's like, I'm a professional, and I sucked it up, and I did it, but if they had told me, I wouldn't have gone. I just don't want to leave people hanging. Yeah. So when it comes to, like, maybe context, or in the same way where you have an idea what kind of content you're going to get before you get into a movie, mm-hmm. this contains nudity, violence, explicit scenes, whatever, at least that much, just so someone can know, be like, oh, no, this is against my religion, personal philosophy, my feelings, or whatever. Mm-hmm. But just, like, personally, I do a lot better if I don't know what it's for.
I think I would, too. I hadn't thought about that, but I think I would, like, if let's say I was in your position, and they had told me right off the bat, oh, this is for Mass Effect, I probably would have exploded.
Yeah.
So I would prefer not to know. Yeah, that's a good point.
That's really useful. Like, there was a point where I used to do a lot of private sessions with Richard Horvitz, and one day I walked in and I was like, you know, I just have to tell you, I think I'm finally not excited about you. Like, you know what I was talking about? I was like, good, now we can finally do work.
Nice, because so yeah.
Every time before, I was like, hi, Richard, hi. Which means, like, everything's going through that stupid filter.
Yeah.
Of, I don't even know what's happening right now. Right?
Right.
It's useless. It's a waste of everyone's time.
Yeah, and so they can't talk to you as yourself either. They're like, you know what, let's just move on.
I've said this too, like, I've gotten to do a few animated shows where I'm working with, like, people that I watched on TV growing up, like, actors that I recognize, and I can't be, like, about it. I have to be, like, I have to pretend I've never met them and be, like, hi, nice to meet you, I'm Frida. You're so-and-so. Great. I totally didn't watch every episode of every show you were on. And let's just do work. And it's not trying to be soulless or too cool or disconnected. It's just, especially with VO, the clock is ticking. Like, we start at this time, and then we have to be out of the studio by this time, and they have to have gotten what they needed.
Right.
Or it costs more money, and then everyone's in trouble, and you don't want it to be your fault.
Right.
Yeah.
So, just be cool.
Just really breathe and be cool. Pretend like you're not a huge fan. What's your favorite types? Subway 2323 in the chat says, what's your favorite types of scenes to voice act? Those right there.
That's all the sex scenes. Every sex scene in Andromeda is exactly like that, or like that really good RuPaul's Drag Race video I posted the other day, which had me crying. It was so good. Favorite type of just like scenes in general?
Yeah.
In the world?
In the world.
It's actually really fun. I mean, I got to do some of this in Andromeda, but just like being myself and being super sarcastic and deadpan, because so when you get into like the technical structure of writing, there's usually at least one or some heightened character, so those are like your really goofy or really punctuated notes, or like the funny guy, the serious whatever, and then someone or someone's has to be the straight man who is reacting to the other stuff. So like, for example, in Mass Effect, I'm the straight man technically. Mm-hmm. Right. I'm the normal human who's there for you to react to and experience all this other like really fantastical, really far pushed, like, you know, there's the Krogan, he's the cranky one, like, you know, or he's the Klingon, he's the serious one. Uh-huh. It's that sort of thing. Someone has to be vanilla for you, because otherwise everything's too loud.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So I like it when I get those moments in Mass Effect, when I get to be straight, the straight man, and also just like deadpan and be like, yep. Because those because those are basically like the nice, those are like the punchlines for a lot of jokes too.
Yeah.
If someone else in the scene is just like acting really heightened and crazy and doing a great job, and you just get to be like, yep. Because that also gives the moment for the audience to like digest how ridiculous this thing is.
Yeah, especially if it's like that timing is hit.
Yeah, getting comedic timing right is really satisfying. And it's also a thing that like can't control. You can only do it based on like reaction.
Mm-hmm.
And this thing where like stand-up comics don't know if their jokes are funny. They really don't. Like, comics write jokes by themselves, and then they go on stage and they're like, and hope for the best. And that's when they figure out what's funny, what's a dead joke, what needs to be rewritten. Uh-huh. And the same thing with VO is like, I don't know if you think this is going to be amusing or funny. So let's see. Okay, cool. I got it. Getting that feedback from whoever's in the control booth, even though we're not doing for an audience, is just really, really valuable.
Right.
Yeah. So, yeah.
So Shippy Gem asks, do you have any funny stories about recording Like, were you ever given a weird direction, or the line was just so absurd that you had to say, oh my God, what am I doing with my life kind of moment?
I think everybody involved in the VO pipeline just has moments of like, you guys, this is our job. This is so dumb. Oh, well, hey, for Andromeda, I got to do my first mouth-kissing Foley. That was fun. I got to do my own porno Foley. Like, no, you know, slapping chicken cutlets together or anything. But I did have to make out with my hand, which really? Is really cool. Yeah, which is really, spoiler, which is really cool as an adult in front of, like, your adult engineer and your adult director and just them. But, like, again, like, I can't think about them. I can't see them. I, like, had to turn my head way off and still stay on mic because I'm like, I can't deal with your nonsense right now. I have to make out with myself. Shut up.
Turn off the lights, please.
Yeah. And get through that and stuff like that. And again, like, take it seriously. Nothing else matters. Da-da-da. So yeah, making out with my hand, that's my great accomplishment this year.
I always wondered about that. If the voice actors, each voice actor, do they do their little kissing scenes, or is that just like someone random that does the kissing scenes, like some tech or something?
It, for film, for post-production, for film, that's some crusty old 60-year-old white Foley man who I've probably met making out with himself sometimes. Yeah. Like, unless, I mean, you don't really need the actors unless you have something that involves vocalization.
Right.
Unless you have something that has, but even then, like, they bring in voice matches all the time.
Yeah.
Like, for films, very commonly voice actors will get auditions because the original actor is too busy, too expensive, or whatever. Mm-hmm. So they get someone close enough. Sure. Heavy breathing or whatever. Also, because sometimes production, just the production audio just didn't pick it up properly.
Right.
It just doesn't sound good. So that's just part of the gig.
Yeah.
Not with your hands.
That's funny.
Middle school quality technical work here.
Someone actually wanted, if you could say something in Sarah Ryder's voice.
I would, but I'm afraid to, because again, getting my pizza serving. But yeah. It's just not, like I said.
Say something and not having to do with the game.
This has nothing to do with the game.
Nice. You got Sarah Ryder right there. It has nothing to do with
basically, the game. Well, like I said, it really is, like, I've been asked, so what was your process to find the character? And it's the same thing. It's like, okay, so for you, what was, y'all, so Denise, what was your process like the last time you were dumped? How did you find you were dumped? How did you get there? What emotions? You're like, I don't know. I got dumped and I had feelings.
And it happened.
It's the same thing. It's just like, okay, well, they just, like, lob a bunch of information at me, again, about, like, the situation and that character's background. I'm like, okay, well, this is happening to me. This is what's coming out. And they're like, cool. They're, I mean, really, really good directors, too, won't necessarily do, like, can you, again, like, looking at Bob's Burgers, they won't say, can you talk higher? Can you talk lower? They might do stuff like, can you go younger? Right. But younger, again, is not pitch, it's attitude. And behavior and the way, like, you react to stuff, like the way, well, I mean, I can't speak for everyone, but the way you react when you're 3 and you're told you can't have a cookie should be different than how you react when you're 20. Yeah. And you're told you can't have a cookie. Maybe it's the same for you. I don't know. I'm not judging. I'm just saying that informs your reaction.
Yeah. Mm.
So, okay, let's see.
You kiss her right hand right now. This whole time you wouldn't know.
Let's ask a fun question. Jamal Jackson asks, what is your favorite sci-fi universe?
All of them. I've had a joke with my agency for the last 2 years that I'm just like space lady and alternately sometimes brown space lady and sometimes gay space lady and sometimes brown gay space lady. I'm in space a lot, and sometimes Latina or some other foreign ethnicity, and then sometimes gay, and I don't, that's all fun for me, because it's just, like, totally projecting who I am. Yeah. I think, I don't know, I'm sorry, I still think Deep Space Nine is, like, the best of the series of Star Trek.
Really?
And so, we don't have to fight about it, I'm just saying.
Well, I'm just kidding.
Well, I think, I don't know, even, like, between Star Wars and other known sci-fi universes, I think, like, DS9 appeals to me the most, just because it was so, the whole promenade set. So like, whereas, let's get into it. Whereas Next Generation and then the original is all, that's all about like exploration, and every episode had to be like encountering a new civilization, a new type of species, personality, mm-hmm. some new type of problems, some new type of combat. The majority of Deep Space Nine happens on Deep Space Nine. It's a stationary setting where the problems and the conflicts come to them.
Oh, right.
And they had to keep it all in order. Mm-hmm. There's a very different dynamic, and I feel like that also brought in a lot of intrigue with the storyline, because every time they had conflicts, they were internal and ongoing, so the story arcs could be a lot broader, like the whole Cardassian Bajoran thing. Mm-hmm. We were talking about, like, you know, racial genocide and whatever else. It had an ongoing arc that didn't have to be resolved in an hour episode, mm-hmm. or whatever. So yeah, I like that one. I also like, those were, I think, all those characters who were like people I'd want to hang out with.
Yeah,
like Jadzia Dax is cool as hell.
There was some really cool characters in all Star Trek. You'll find an awesome character.
Yeah, they're touting now that they've hired their first Black African, like a female African American lead. She's not a lead, she's a lieutenant. They're still they're making her third best, which still annoys me, because they're like, diversity, we fixed it, you're welcome.
Look at us, be proud.
We did it. Nah, man, she's still a lieutenant, she's not in charge, so until I see an HBIC, POC, I'm not down with OPP.
You like Star Wars?
Uh-oh. Like anybody, so I'm 34, so like anybody growing up with the originals, you know, those were like enchanting, and I was enamored with them and whatever. Mm-hmm. And then the prequels came out, and I was like, well, I don't believe in anything anymore. There's no point to life, and everything's meaningless. So like other people, I'm like kind of slowly coming back around to caring. It's just like, once you've been betrayed and once you've been hurt, you just don't trust people anymore. So I thought Force Awakens was, I was expecting nothing, so getting something was definitely better than nothing. I thought it was okay. I thought it was good. I was engaged. I haven't seen Rogue One yet. I'm going to. I had to get Moana out of the way because I was behind on that. Mm-hmm. Also, I'm not a first opening night with too many people crowd.
Me neither. But
I am the bitch that will turn around and say, can you stop talking? And I will say it at the top of my lungs, and I will stare at you until you shut up. Or like, can you stop kicking my seat? Thanks! That's me. I will do that. And the best way to not do that in the first place is to wait.
Yeah, when you're, there's nobody sitting behind you.
So I'm looking forward to Rogue One. I will say, so this was disappointing. Not too long ago, what's her face? Felicity Jones, who's the lead in Rogue One, mm-hmm. did this little joke promo video where she's like, look, I know Daisy Ridley and I, who's Rey mm-hmm. from Force Awakens, and I look similar, but we're not the same. And I'm like, you're taking the fact that they hired two back-to-back white female leads who do look similar and making it into a joke and kind of like talking it down, rather than pointing out that they did hire two white girls back-to-back and called it a day and patted themselves on the back. It is kind of crappy. They could have done better.
Yeah.
They're like, but look, the white girl has seven dwarves of all colors. you still kind of half-assed it. So, but with, you know, that out of the way, I mean, I think anybody who actively wants to hate stuff, who just like is dying to hate and tear apart other people's work, has a lot more going on, and you should feel sorry for them because they're expecting, like, life is not forever, guys. And if you spend your time just like hating stuff that other people put in years of their life into, mm-hmm. you have a lot of problems that you need to address in your own life. I never go to movies being like, I can't wait to hate this.
I don't get that mentality.
People do. Do you? I mean, you might know. So because I've watched some reaction videos on YouTube, now YouTube thinks I'm obsessed with Mass Effect, which is really funny because now I watched this interview with Frieda Wolf. I'm like, oh, God damn it.
you love this one.
Yeah. There's actually, I mean, no surprise, but a bunch of people on YouTube, of course, have spent 15, 20, 30 minutes after editing videos talking about why Mass Effect Andromeda is going to suck and why they hate it and why they hate everyone who's working on it. Everything is terrible. And it's like, but like, That doesn't make me upset. What makes me upset is that someone gave up 2 to 3 hours of their life.
Yeah.
I know.
That's really sad.
And, like, actually, if there's editing in it, it's like, you really, really? You spent that much trouble to edit it and everything?
It's hard to say how much everything sucks that they don't have yet. That apple pie that I haven't eaten yet is gonna suck. It's good apple pie. Apples are Satan. And I'm gonna make a 8-minute video about why. And you're gonna click on it.
And then later they're gonna eat it and they're gonna be like, oh.
Yeah, but they're not gonna make a video.
They're not gonna make a video, no.
No, I mean, like, I appreciate guys like you, ladies like you, and everybody. I mean, I've said this, like, people ask, like, what do you think of the Mass Effect fandom? And I'm like, y'all are high on ecstasy, obviously.
Obviously.
Everyone just wants to touch each other's faces and say, I love you, which is great. Great.
It's awesome.
But it's really, I mean, the most commonly, the majority of, like, especially gaming communities and movie communities are people who are complaining and having a bad time and want to take time out of their day to talk about why they're complaining versus the people who are busy having a great time are busy having a great time. They're not going to go make really long ranty threads or YouTube videos or whatever talking about what a wonderful time they had. Those are far and few between.
Yeah.
So it was actually, it's really touching to me that the BioWare fandom does take the time to be vocally positive. That is really different for gamers.
Oh yeah.
Honestly. Because everyone's online the second they want to complain about something, but the second they're, like, warm and fuzzy inside and having a nice time, they don't tell anybody about it. They just, like, you know, hold they keep the feeling now. Themselves.
I'm a gamer. I can't talk about that.
You talk about my feelings? I don't... I'm hard, man. I'm hardcore. I'm not a casual gamer. I don't... I've only fueled with hatred and energy drinks. Anyway. Yeah. So, just hats off to... I mean, I'm sure BioWare has a lot to do with that, too. It's just, like... I mean, the fact that they even bother, like, no game company is obligated to do any sort of community outreach whatsoever.
I know.
And from what I've seen, BioWare definitely takes steps between, like, N7 Day and, like, feeding you guys teasers and trailers. And, like, I saw you got to go to Edmonton not too long ago.
Yeah, I just got back a few, it's been a week now. And that was amazing to see the way that they work, the hard work that they're doing, and just how open they are, like you're saying. They're just so welcoming to the fans and stuff, and you don't really see that, and a lot of people don't realize that for some
reason. That's a really nice feedback loop to be a part of and see. Again, it's not that common in games, and it's not required.
They reach out a lot. They reached out to me. I had a transplant last year, and Zender Kwai, he made a design for me for a t-shirt. He's an artist tech over there at BioWare, a senior artist. And he made a design for a t-shirt for me so I can get the word out there that I needed a kidney. So that's, like, pretty amazing.
Yeah. Wow.
You know, so.
Yeah, they're sweethearts.
Yeah, they're really good.
So that's how I feel about it. Like, I feel really lucky. This is not an opportunity that I asked for, but I'm on for the ride, and I feel pretty, pretty grateful about it.
Yeah, it's a good community. And some people just don't get it, and they'll be like, demanding things and like, why don't they show this and why don't they show us that? And it's just like, think of like Bethesda or Blizzard, or as great companies as they are, or like Rockstar. They don't show things until it's like ready, and they're like, oh, and by the way, this game's coming out next month, and it's like, oh wow, oh, okay, cool. But BioWare is like constantly showing us little tidbits and giving us here and there and getting us excited and stuff, so it's a nice community.
That's them being very vulnerable. Like, I mean, all the AAA companies that you mentioned, they're terrified. Well, because it's exactly what we talked about. If they show something that is less than close to final or polished or has something changed later on, like a release date or something, they're gonna have to deal with the wrath of people with way too much time, way too much anger, just like invading their boards with nonsense of like, you lied to me. That's why I quit Facebook. Facebook makes you a community manager who doesn't get paid of your own page, and I'm like, this is a paid job. I don't want to do this for free. Nope.
You know what? I think it's time for quickfire time.
Oh no, what is this?
What is this?
You have to answer the question like right away.
Oh God.
Tom cheated with this. He like took his time.
I know, he's like, oh, this isn't fair.
Okay.
Would you want to start the honors, Denise? Okay.
Well, go ahead with the first one. I know that's something that you asked.
Oh, I don't know if you're into this, but if you're not, you could just say no. Marvel or DC?
Both.
Oh.
I work for both. I can't. I work for both. I love them both. They're both really nice. Recognize me.
Analog or digital?
No! Both! I'm just going to be that really annoying little Chinese. Why not both?
Why not, though? Dogs or cats?
Cats, obviously!
Okay, that one was easy.
They pee in a box. I wish I peed in a box.
Favorite time of day?
Sleeping.
Sleepy time. Favorite musician or band?
I'll stick to Tool. Tool as a kid, Tool's an adult.
Oh, good. Favorite song?
Oh, Caught a Light Sleaze by Tori. Caught a Light Sneeze by Tori Amos, probably still.
Okay. 80s, 90s, or today? Yeah. What was that?
90s. Yeah, I'm stuck in the 90s.
Me too.
I'm just going to be stuck in my adolescence forever. Also, it's coming back.
It is.
Little teenage pretending that they grew up in the 90s and wearing velvet chokers. It's fine. I should have just saved all mine and sold them on eBay.
Favorite movie?
Fifth Element.
Which one?
Fifth Element.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Favorite TV show?
There's so much TV right now. Oh, X-Files.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, if we gotta go with, like Desert Island, X-Files.
Totally.
Yeah.
Favorite book?
When's the last time I read a book? I used to have a giant hard-on for Neil Gaiman. Probably Neverwhere.
I've heard that one's really good.
Yeah.
I'm gonna take one from the chat. Cake or pie?
Oh, ice cream, which goes on pie, or an ice cream cake. Why not both?
Oh yeah, you could put ice cream on both.
Yeah.
So anything you could favorite, put ice cream on.
Favorite genre
of anything?
Yeah.
Probably sci-fi. I like my fantasy stuff too, but sci-fi just has like stuff. And the same way where people are like, you can't have a female character who's a warrior fighting dragons because that's not really believable. You can't prove it with science, but the dragon's fine. People like set up these really dumb little rules for the framework of like what can't like Max Landis, who's John Landis's kid, so John Landis being American Werewolf in Paris. Da 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 da. I one time saw Max Landis quote his dad. I love this. His dad was like, how do you become a vampire? Any way you want. Vampires aren't real.
Yeah, yeah.
I think people who work in sci-fi are usually more willing to like break the framework of what can and can't happen in a sci-fi film than people in fantasy tend to like follow these very specific. We have rules about magic and dragons, okay? And whether women can hold swords, where there are rules and we must adhere to them.
Why?
Yeah.
Text or call?
Call. Nice. I don't have that weird. I do have some of the weird millennial anxiety, but okay. Just real quick. This is not quick now. So Aziz Ansari put out a really amazing book last year called A Modern Romance, and it's not a comedy book. It's about how phones and internet are screwing up our mating. It's just changing the way we communicate, our mating rituals, the way we choose partners, how our relationships go. And scientific fact, the muscles in our brain for live conversation are atrophying because how much time we spend in text, in email, on Twitter, on Facebook. When the majority of your communication, think about them, if the majority of the communication in your day is premeditated and thought out, and you do autocorrect and you correct your punctuation, you take time to choose an emoji. This being able to have a conversation, that muscle does shrink. It's a muscle in your brain and it's going away.
Oh my God.
Yeah. And I'm an actor. I have to do it with my mouth.
So I can't really be like, can I just like literally phone this in and text my performance, please? I don't really get that. So I would try to just like, you know, be present and deal with people. Also, text is really passive because like, I know you're there. You're answering my text. Just answer the question now. You're sitting, you're on the toilet. Just call me. I don't care.
Do you have a pet peeve?
All of them. People.
Everything.
People are my pet peeve. No, I think like what I said earlier, just like people who are super disrespectful or just like sort of like in their, okay, yeah, that's, just the concept of like when someone goes into a movie theater but they treat it like it's their living room.
Yeah.
That kind of lack of awareness.
Mm-hmm.
That's the thing that makes me stand and be like, excuse me, hello, hello. I also paid $15 for this movie. You will stop now. Thank you.
Oh, so a lot of people asking things in the chat. Tea or coffee?
Oh, coffee. Oh, it keeps me alive. Yeah. This game brought to you by coffee.
Favorite comedian?
I see people talk about George Carlin. Yeah, George Carlin's a granddad. It'd be really interesting if he was around right now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Ewoks or Tribbles? What's Tribbles?
Tribbles are the little fuzzy eyeless, tailless things in Star Trek. They're just like furball props that are supposedly alive.
Oh, that sounds adorable. So yeah, Ewoks or Tribbles?
Ewoks, because you could train them to bring you drinks, and Tribbles, you'd probably accidentally vacuum. I have Tribbles in my house now. They're called giant cat hair tumbleweeds.
I have Tribbles.
Me off. Yeah.
That's funny. Okay. God, there's so many. Favorite snack food. We'll ask two more, and then we'll be on our way.
Oh, my God. Tortilla chips. Sometimes I'll eat tortilla chips with nothing. It's a desperate time.
That is a desperate time when you start eating them with nothing. It's like, oh, nothing. This is kind of sad, them. But they're good anyways.
Yeah. See, I'm not alone.
Yep.
Let's see. Writing or acting?
Oh, riding with a T. I was like, yes, I love horses. definitely acting. I always get a lot more satisfaction if I can make somebody else's creative vision real. That's what it's just like. It's satisfying because you're like, because when you get it right, and by right is just like going with your gut and doing something you believe in, you can like look up and see the writers in their face and they're like, my baby. It's like their baby drowning.
Aw.
Yeah, it's the same kind of like, and that's really satisfying.
Yeah. Oh, gosh. Sarah Ryder or Scott Ryder.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Is there really, you're like, is that even a question?
Fair. It's very fair. Me, obviously, but that's just... That's just because if I'm the hero, then he's the sibling, and the sibling just isn't as present as they, like, you know, the hero's in first person the whole time because you're there in that body.
Mm-hmm.
And then the sibling's just sort of, like, around. So, me, obviously, but that's only, that's contextual. That's contextual.
Are you going to be playing Mass Effect Andromeda?
Yeah.
Are you going to be playing Sarah Ryder?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I have to. Also, just, like, I've said this elsewhere, too. I just want to, here, because we do the whole thing again like in solitary, so I don't do it, get to do it off of other actors, and like every cutscene you see, we weren't in a room together.
Mm-hmm.
The mocap actors were, like, you guys have seen some behind the scenes stuff and the videos I've released of mocap actors on sound stages doing their thing, but I didn't get to be there with the other voice actors or mocap actors or whatever, so I would just like really like to see how the stuff I did fits in context,
right?
Yeah,
because otherwise, like, I don't get to see the finished product. Like I said, like, anybody who works on a project this big, all you can do is just make sure your portion of the work is as shipshape as you can get it.
Yeah,
and hope for the best. But what ends up coming in the resulting thing is that remains to be seen. So I think it would be just like with anybody, like, it would be weird and a shame to just like walk away from a big project you work on and not have the emotional investment where you want to see how it ended up.
Yeah, absolutely. So we've still got so many questions, and Denise, I think this is a good time to do the giveaway, but we were talking, since AD Ability Drain wasn't able to join us, unfortunately, Frida is totally down to doing a part two, And this time we'll do like we'll hopefully get our cameras working, and we'll have like a little party on, and we'll do the Space Girls that we were talking about. So, but yeah, we'll save a lot of your guys' questions. A lot of the questions in the chat, I've got them on the video. So, Denise, go ahead and do the giveaway.
All right, so Luna C Squared, are you here? If you are, you have won the game. If you respond, say Luna hello. Luna C Squared, are you here still?
Were they here in the beginning?
I don't know.
I haven't seen somebody by that name.
Let me see. Yeah, I don't see her. Okay, no one's responding. Is that you, Robot Emperor? Because you said woo. Woo!
They're like,
maybe they're just being supportive.
Yeah.
Won a game. Dragon Rider, are you Luna C Squared on YouTube? Oh my gosh.
I want to win a game.
Or people could just be lying. Yes, that's me. That's me in a different
handle. Yeah, I know. That's totally me.
Handle.
No, that's me.
Can we have a raffle before part two? Oh, you want to do it before part two? You don't want it now? You don't want the game now? What? No? Okay. Let me see who's in the chat first, then.
I'm going to take this giveaway time to give away a piece of myself, and that is to go pee. So I will be right back. Good luck, guys.
Okay. I can't see who's in the chat. Let me see.
I can be her.
Yeah, I can be her.
I don't think they're here.
Yeah, Luna, she's not here. Okay, if you participated in the giveaway, just type something right now. Type Sarah Ryder right now, and I'll randomly pick someone. I should probably not want to win. Oh, Cinder Quad.
But I kind of do. He's like, I'm totally Luna. Yeah, we're not falling for that one, Nick.
Oh, okay. Now they're starting.
Oh, gosh. Ooh.
Ooh.
Lots of peoples. Well, you've got quite a few people to pick from. That's good.
Yeah.
Lord of Ulster, Scott Ryder.
Mark us all down. All right. Randomly pick. I'm like scrolling back and forth really fast. let's see. Rocky Shepherd, you win.
Yay, Rocky Shepherd. For part two, we'll try to do another giveaway for part two. I'll look into that as well.
Okay, cool.
Rocky Shepherd.
Don't tell me Rocky Shepherd left.
He
now.
Immediately left. He or she? Are they there? Rocky Shepherd. There they are.
Yeah,
yes.
Okay, cool.
Cassandra Pentagast? What are you talking about, Nick? Cassandra forever.
Okay, so I'll send you a message, Rocky.
Awesome. Thank you so much for coming, you guys, and for participating. There's so many of you. That's awesome. So we'll... Oh, there... Yeah, there, she's back. Datcast, though. We got a winner!
Congratulations!
Alright, cool. So, Frida, thank you so much for joining us, and thank you for just being so awesome, even after all those technical difficulties.
Thanks for having me. Anytime. I mean, I mean, why stop now? You will hear my voice in game, and you will hear me now. Project your own image of yourself onto my voice. I will be your voice forever.
You guys wanted to hear Sarah Ryder. Well, you heard her here.
It's exactly like that. I am the Pathfinder. I'm finding the path. It's not like I'm, like, lost on my way to the bar.
Oh, there's someone who I guess was really trying really hard to get his questions in. He just wanted one question answered. Do you mind answering one more before you go?
Of course.
The Watcher 105 asks, I'm not understanding what's good. Do you have any role for a role you may really like? Maybe flipping out into something monstrous or angelic. I guess what your preference is between when you have to pick between those.
Oh man. You can hate any role real quick if it shreds your voice because it's putting you out of commission and it's painful. Uh-huh. I like doing creature-y, monster-y stuff, but it's gotta be within the limitations of like, and this is what I can do before my throat explodes. So that can be fun. I mean, versus like, again, with Mass Effect, that's more about stamina than performance, of like having the stamina for each 4-hour session to be like, I am as bright eyed as bushy tail as the last 400. I don't care if it breaks NDA. The goal for each session was to get at least 350 lines done per session, per 4-hour session. And to give you, I mean, a line could be, I should go. A line should also be like a 3-sentence paragraph. Mm-hmm. 350 of those in 4 hours.
Oh, 4 hours, my goodness.
Yeah, and it's got to get done. Oh, you know what? Here's a generic, but actually true answer. I've gotten to play quite a few comic book villains in the last year that aren't announced yet. One's coming out before the other.
Nice.
Yeah, I've gotten to be some villains, and those are super fun because like I've gotten some episodes where it like revolves around what my character's doing. Mm-hmm. Heroes have to always have to win, and they always have to be like straight laced and like, because good is good. And it's really kind of boring. This is boring because what's right is right. Take a nap, Superman. If you go through like comic book canon, villains have to be much more creative about what their motives are, how they hate their parents, and like come up with original ideas how to take over the world or blow stuff up or whatever. So there's just like a lot more going on for building that character versus being, you know, again, like the hero that's reacting to stuff like the JLA or whatever. So I'm actually really happy that people keep pocketing me as like typecasting me as villains and stuff, because I really get to play there. That's when I get to be like the crazy extreme, right, very specific flavor versus like, I'm reacting to you. I don't like it. So I hope that answers your questions. Dragons are chocolate. One of those is edible.
You could eat dragons.
Yeah. You could. I actually like dragon more. I don't like chocolate. I'm not a good girl. I like anything but chocolate. Husband is booing. You get more chocolate. You get all the chocolate I don't eat. Lucky. Nice. Yeah, no, give me all the caramel and vanilla stuff and all the toffees. Just don't give me the chocolate.
Ooh, vanilla's good, though. I like chocolate,
right?
Vanilla, yeah.
Right? This just turned real slumber party heavy.
I'm like, oh my god!
The food is in my mouth!
That's part two.
Yeah.
No, well, yeah, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you!
Is there anything that you would like to tell people to check out, or anything that you could talk about that you're doing that's coming up?
To play this really cool game called Mass Effect Andromeda. I heard it's coming out sometime next year. Potentially in the spring of 2017. Knock on wood. Man, that's the thing that's out. Like, I'm looking at my IMDb because nobody tells me when things are announced or are out. What you know is what I know, wink wink. Just keep a lookout for Andromeda. And I'm sure, like, between now and then, BioWare will probably continue to do what they do, where they, you know, give little teasers and bits and information to keep invested. I just picked up my Game Informer yesterday. I finally found a Game Informer with the female on the cover. I'm going to go take it framed. Get it framed.
Oh, nice. I got the female one, too.
Yay! So, maybe you should play Andromeda. Maybe I'll be playing with you, and then maybe we can talk about it.
Oh, that'd be cool.
Nice. Well, yeah, thanks so much for tuning in, guys. And again, we'll let you guys know when we're going to do part two with the rest of the questions, because we got so many, and hopefully Ability Drain could join us in that time as well.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, we'll do this again. Happy holidays, happy new year, everybody.
Yes, thank you. Same to you. Okay, guys. Thank you. So this will be saved on my channel here on Twitch, and I believe we will also upload it on to YouTube and on our individual channels. Denise, what's your YouTube channel?
It's just DTakes23.
Yeah, go subscribe to her, because you're also making a lot of Mass Effect videos as well, right?
Yeah, I do like a variety of stuff.
Okay, cool. Yeah. And if you want to follow Frida on Twitter, it's at Frida Wolf, right?
Yep, FrydaWolff. And then 12 more Fs that are hidden in there somewhere, probably.
Okay, have a nice day, you guys. Thank you.
Bye, guys.
Bye.